I come in last night about a 10:30. That baby of mine wouldn't let me in.
David, welcome back to Team Pitiful Raw. Today, in the hot seat, Forrest and Mr. Kane. Why don't you guys check that out? And while you're doing that, we've got a Halloween costume contest to attend, so we'll see you in a bit.
When Days came along, I thought I would do the intelligent thing and do some research on her breed and about specific dietary needs, exercise, training tips. The use of breed-specific led me to breed-specific legislation. Over the next couple of years, I would delve deeper into breed-specific legislation, particularly Denver, Colorado. In the summer of 2008, the group I was working with in Southern California got wind of a story coming out of Denver. A dog by the name of Forrest, who is a pit bull and English Mastiff mix, wandered from nearby Commerce City, Colorado, into Denver. Because of the city's ban on pit bulls, Forrest was placed on death row and remained there for the entire summer. Because of Forrest's incarceration and his innocence, a massive campaign started globally. People from as far away as New Zealand, Australia, and Europe rallied for Forrest's release. Everybody has an opinion about our president, Barack Obama. Personally, if I was given the opportunity, I would shake his hand for saving Forrest's life. President Obama's presidential campaign ended in Denver in September of 2008. At that time, we were making such a stink that the city was more than willing to give the dog up if we would take him out of the state and leave very, very quickly and quietly. Not even out of the state of Colorado yet, I submitted my application to Strays Rescue of St. Louis, Missouri to adopt Forrest outright. Hours after that happened, I announced to my family and friends that Days and I would be taking a little road trip out to Denver, Colorado to pick up our new adopted dog, Forrest. Little did I know that the return trip to California would not include two dogs, but three. Enter Mr. Kane. For those who are involved in rescue and rescue transport, this is a very familiar story. For those who are not involved in rescue, you can check out Run Forrest Run, The Long Road from Exile here on YouTube. I caution you, bring your box of Kleenex. What can I tell you about Forrest? Forrest is what I like to describe the canine equivalent of a throw pillow. The only thing that Forrest can ever be accused of is being habitually curious and compelled to wander and explore and sniff everything in God's creation. Having spent a very hands-on over three years now with Forrest, I can honestly say that this dog is not capable of being aggressive. Forrest is not capable of fighting. He avoids any kind of confrontation, any kind of negative vibe in the air. It's just his character. It's the way he is. I've seen him in every sort of situation possible, and he responds pretty much the same way. I just want to get out of here. I don't want to be near this. I'm gone. The old cliche, you can't judge a book by its cover, definitely applies to Forrest. Although not the biggest dog in the dog park, Forrest's head is about the size of your garden variety bowling ball, and he is definitely built like a Sherman tank. As of fall 2011, we discovered that Forrest has a small little burr on one of his vertebrae, which is causing him some discomfort with his left rear hindquarter and hip. But under the watchful and careful eye of Dr. McGee of Aspen Arbor Animal Hospital in Broomfield, Colorado, we project that Forrest is going to live out a fairly normal and healthy life. And then there's Mr. Kane, a.k.a. the K-Man.
This is Officer Gabriel, Denver PD. I know that you're in there with that dog. You know you've had a pit bull violation in the past, so we are going to be coming in to get that dog. It would be much to your advantage and the dog's advantage, so nobody gets hurt, to just come to the front door and give us the dog. Because they are going to take it. You're going to have to fight it in court, but we're going to get that dog no matter what. So for the dog's safety and everybody else's safety, come to the front door now.
Needless to say, Kane's beginnings in this world were quite tough. What Officer Gabriel of Denver PD failed to mention in this recording was the fact that the previous violation was instigated by Denver Police Department and Animal Control. Kane's previous violation was the textbook definition of entrapment. Three animal control officers arrived at the house where Kane was living and rocked the iron gate until it came off its tracks. From there, they lured Kane out onto the sidewalk and into the street, therefore he was running at large. Over the past 4 years, I've explained this story to several people, and the response is typically always the same. They can't do that. Well, here in Denver, Colorado, that's exactly what they do. It's how the city and their home rule authority rolls. Kane's situation, along with Forrest and over 5,000 other dogs confiscated or exiled from Denver, is the very foundation of what the Team Pitiful organization fights against. On September 19, 2008, we went to death row at Denver Municipal Animal Shelter to spring Kane. We met with our good friend and longtime opponent of Denver's pit bull ban, Sonia Diaz. This experience was both humbling and what nightmares are made of, for obvious reasons. Unlike Days, Kane was quite off the rack in regard to pre-existing issues. Kane was friendly and social, extremely playful with people and other dogs. Kane knew to be gentle around small children and seniors. He was very family-oriented and a welcome addition to the team. Just a few highlights of Kane's existence with us for the first 6 months of being a member of Team Pitiful. His never-failing love for cream cheese. Kane loves to wrestle with his little sister Days, and Kane decided to tell me of his love for women, all women, two-legged and four. Around 6 months into the relationship, Kane got into an incident with an English Mastiff at our local dog park. The English Mastiff was about twice Kane's size and weight, but that did not stop Kane from giving just as good as he got. For the next 6 months to 1 year, Kane went on a massive offensive against other male dogs. Dogs that were overexcitable, dogs that came too close to his dad, and dogs that were unneutered became targets of brutal attacks. After two major incidents and several thousands of dollars putting other people's dogs back together, we discontinued going to the dog park and began training this undesirable behavior out of Kane. We went out of our way to find other understanding and responsible owners who would work with us in resocializing Kane. I upped his exercise routine and Kane was never left unsupervised. After three quarters of a year into it, Kane was meeting a threesome of corgis at a local pet expo and got bit on the nose by one of the male dogs. Kane's response? He laid down to get to the other dog's level and began to wag his tail. My response to the dog's owner? Well, let's just say the tongue lashing can still be heard echoing throughout the greater Los Angeles basin. Now 3 years since our last episode with Kane, I can proudly report that Kane is doing extremely well, and the bond that has developed between our entire team is ironclad. Well, we thank you for tuning in to Team Pitiful Raw Part 2. Come back and see us in a couple weeks, and we'll do the grand finale here. Please keep in mind, don't buy when you can adopt, and please always spay and neuter. See you again.